October 1st, 2007, you're being kept slightly past the hour of 7 o'clock. This meeting will be called to order. We have a motion to admit Mr. Nasseri.
Mr. Moderator, I move that the following persons be admitted to the meeting. Greg Bellaconis, Town Administrator. Joseph Cassoni, Finance Director. Robert Turow, Transcript of the Freedom of the Floor. Darren Klein, Town Council. Paula Dumont, Assessor. Dave Hanlon, DPW. Seth Albon, Comcast. Scott Hardway, North Reading. NRSD, Freedom of the Floor. Wayne Hattica, North Reading School Department, Freedom of the Floor. Helena Milton, Library Director. Eugene Torek, Town IT Department. Heidi Griffin, Planning Administrator. Giles Morton, Youth Services Committee. Manuel R. Foster, 9 McIntyre Drive. Cal Nelson, School Business Committee.
We have a motion to admit. Any discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? Everyone this evening should be wearing a green ribbon if they're a registered voter. The town boards and committees can sit in the center section in the first three or four rows. Guests should be seated to my right in the first three or four rows. I would ask everybody if they would please turn off their cell phone. The tellers for this evening, counting the front and to my left, Tricia Colella, counting the middle section, Joe Vigante, and counting to my right, Bill Reed. Mr. Nasseri.
Mr. Moderator, I move to dispense with the reading of the warrant and to refer to the articles by number and further to dispense with the reading of the return of service by the constable.
We have a motion, discussion. Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous? I actually almost forgot the Pledge of Allegiance, but it's my sincere hope that we'll be home to see that on television at the football game. I've also been told that if we're not out of here in time for the football game, I'm going to have opposition in the next election. Mr. Nasseri, would you lead us in the Pledge of Allegiance, please?
And also the support of the voters who represented us with this great facility.
We moved in on August 28th, and we've been on a shakedown cruise for the last month and a half. We're finding that we truly enjoy being in that facility. It is a pleasure to be in a building that meets the functionality of a modern police department. For the first time, we have the space for our technology, for our training, for our records keeping, and to house our detainees. It is truly a wonderful facility, and what you're looking at is an invitation to the open house being sponsored by the Police Department, the Police Association, and the Building Committee for Sunday, October 14th, between the hours of 10 o'clock in the morning and 2 o'clock in the afternoon. Everybody in this community, the friends and families are welcome. You go through a guided tour, you get an orientation on the department, and truly see what a wonder it is to have a modern police facility in our community for the first time in 40 years. So thank you very much for this opportunity and your support.
North Reading Youth Services has a report to Giles Morton.
Giles Morton, 59 Mount Vernon Street, a member of the Youth Services Committee that was established a year ago at this town meeting under Article 27. We came here a year ago, stood with our hearts in our mouths and on our sleeves, wanting to do something for the young people of North Reading. I'm delighted to announce that after a six-month hiatus, while we waited for the state to approve the legality of the position we were hoping to establish, that we got that approval. We established a Youth Services Committee. We took applications, and we have now 11 members on that committee, local residents and local business owners. In April, we started looking for someone to hire, and after an exhaustive search where we interviewed people from Cape Cod to Amesbury multiple times, and thanks to the work of Alison Olsen in HR and Rick Balakonis, the town administrator, I'm happy to announce that starting next Tuesday, the town of North Reading will have a full-time youth services director to act as a mentor, a friend, and a supporter of the young people of this town. We have in place with the town administrator the salary and benefits for the first year and enough money on hand for programs for that first year. The fundraising is underway for the second year that we guarantee to provide funding for. The person we're hiring is Jenny O'Leary. We did an extensive background check and she's not related to any of our selectmen. She is currently working as a youth services director assistant in a nearby town. She's young, she's vibrant, she's full of energy, she has experience, and I just hope that the population of the town will give her the support, the encouragement she needs to do work for our young people, our most precious resource. Thank you.
Any other town boards or committees wishing to give a report? Seeing none. Further discussion? Seeing none. We have the motion. We hear the reports. All those in favor?
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Mr. Masseri.
Mr. Moderator, I move that the following persons be admitted to the meeting. Lauren Coloruso, Boston Globe Northwest. David Trope, the superintendent. Mark Clark, DPW Water. McKenna-Witch, custodian, freedom of the floor.
We have a motion to admit. Discussion? Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 2, Mr. Masseri.
Mr. Moderator, 2008 operating budget voted under Article 24 of the April 9, 2007 annual town meeting as follows. Line 95, debt service. Insert as a funding source, line 95, fund $87,464.91 from reserve for debt exclusion and $93,695.84 from Department of Energy grant. Line 99, Water Department debt, change the funding source to read line 99, fund $147,431 from water revenue and $150,000 from the state reserve fund by issuance of revenue anticipation notes. Raise and appropriate the sum of $30,251 for line 34, fire department wages. $153,700 for line 94, regional vocational school, as specified in Article 2, as printed in the warrant.
We have the motion. Does the Finance Committee wish to make a recommendation? Discussion. Mr. Massera.
These items are not changes in the amounts that we had voted to spend, but adjustments to the funding sources. I think with one exception, the fire department request has been reduced by about $5,000.
Further discussion. Seeing none, all those in favor of the motion, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 3, Mr. Vino.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I move to transfer from free cash a sum of $9,684.29 and transfer from water revenue the sum of $66,072.48 to pay prior year's bills as specified in Article 3 and printed in the warrant.
We have the motion. Does the Finance Committee wish to make a recommendation?
Mr. Moderator, the Finance Committee recommends this vote.
Mr. Vino, does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation?
The Board of Selectmen recommend unanimously.
Discussion. This is a prior year bill that requires fourth this vote of town meeting. All those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 4. Mr. Gardino.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. I move to transfer from free cash the sum of $158,134 to fund a deficit in the fiscal year 2007 snow and ice budget, as specified in Article 4, as printed in the warrant.
We have the motion. Does the Finance Committee wish to make a recommendation?
The Finance Committee recommends.
Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation?
The Board of Selectmen recommends.
Discussion. Seeing none, all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Unanimous. Article 5, Mr. Vasseri.
Moderator, I move to create a capital improvement stabilization fund as provided in Chapter 40, Section 5B of the General Laws and transfer the sum of $404,250 from free cash for the purpose herein as specified in Article 5 as printed in the warrant.
We have the motion. Does the Finance Committee wish to make a recommendation?
Finance Committee recommends.
Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Mr. Massera.
Board of Selectmen recommends.
Discussion. Discussion. Mr. Messeri.
The purpose of this capital improvement stabilization fund is to assure that one-time revenues are applied to capital projects. In this case, this fund is going to be initially funded from monies derived from the Berry project. The objective is to maintain a ceiling of $960,000 in annual debt service. That's currently what our debt service was this fiscal year. It permits funding for long-delayed capital improvements, such as roof on Town Hall, which is in our capital plan in Article 7, road maintenance program, and Park Street Bridge, along with other capital projects that have been put off due to lack of funding. And it minimizes the impact of the Eisenhower settlements on the tax rate, which we'll also be discussing this evening. The $404,250 that we're putting in from free cash is actually a payment that was made to the town by Lincoln Properties in terms of fees that were paid associated with the project. At next October's town meeting, we will be putting in additional town share, the sale of the Berry Center. The amount of money that Representative Jones helped us get from the state. We have that money, but it hasn't been certified as free cash yet, so we can't move to put that into the fund at this time. We will be doing that next October. Additionally, in next October, we hope to be able to put in the 40-yard density bonus payment of $1,218,000. You may have read in the transcript that the DHCD didn't have that bonus fund funded in their budget this year, but there is move underway to get that funded, and I'm pretty sure that we'll have that money and we'll be able to put it into the fund next October meeting, which will bring the total stabilization fund to $2,153,250, which will allow us to leverage bonding without impacting our annual operating budgets over the next few years. Once with this, we'll be able to deal with a number of capital projects that, as I said earlier, have been put aside year after year after year as we try to balance our operating budget.
Mr. Rowe.
Dana Rowe, 61 Adams Street. I believe Article 5, 6, and 7 should not be acted on at this town meeting. They should be done in April. If you look in the front of the book, it states that it is recommended the stabilization fund set an annual goal, and that stabilization put free cash into it. When we get to April town meeting, we won't have any free cash. I really believe that there's no need of doing this. There's only a few people here. This should be done in April.
Thank you, Mr. Rowe. Mr. O'Brien.
Nick O'Brien, 95 Park Street. Well, first off, I'd like to comment on the attendance. It seems that we don't even have a 130 faithful town meeting attendees here. I, with Mr. Rowe, feel that this is not an article that should be dealt with at this time. I'm concerned about the wording of the article. It makes reference to the fact we have money received in connection with the Berry Center. Am I incorrect? Did I read something wrong? Have we got the dirty end of the stick again? Do we have funds coming in as a result of town meeting accommodating the developer? Would somebody please respond to that? Where is this money that we were supposed to receive? I read the Boston papers, I read the local paper. It states that we will get this money. I'm aware of the program, I'm aware of what's happening, but when we state in the article for money received, I haven't seen it yet. Once again, I don't think this is an article that should be dealt with at this time.
Mr. Hanlon for the question.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Good evening, everyone. To answer Mr. O'Brien's question specifically, you're correct in that the Commonwealth Department of Housing and Community Development was short on the density payments. That's the $1.2 million that Bob Messeri referred to. As we speak, the Executive Office of the Governor has requested that transfer of $15 million into PHCD. We're not the only community that is short right now. Those communities that are qualified today will be covered by that $15 million once it's approved.
Further discussion? Mr. Webster.
No Webster, 51 Spruce Road. Later on tonight, we're going to be asked to approve a rather large amount of money to borrow to pay for land takings at Eisenhower Land, and I'm wondering why we don't take $404,000 and apply it to the fees we owe there.
With respect to the free cash for our COVID, the recap that we received from the finance department shows that there's nearly $190,000 after proposed votes this evening that would be still available for free cash in our COVID.
Mr. Masseri.
Just another comment on the free cash. The $404,250 of Bury Center fees that we're asking to transfer into this funding, those fees are in free cash because payments that come into the town go into the general fund. And it takes town meeting action to move those funds, those received funds, into a specific budget category. And when funds come in during a fiscal year, we can't use those funds until that cash is certified. And that cash was certified at the end of our fiscal year, which ended June 30th, and it is now available. This is not the normal generation of free cash. This is a special one-time event. And we want to put those funds into this special capital fund so that we have money to spend on major capital improvements that we have delayed for a number of years. And the objective of this fund is to stabilize the amount of money our debt service payment each year so that we don't impact our normal operating budgets. This is a positive move, not a negative one. Thank you.
Further discussion? Mrs. Bailey.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Marcy Bailey, 21 Duane Drive. I do support this article as an important financial management tool in getting some of the capital needs in the town addressed. And one of the selectmen can correct me if I'm wrong, but to Mr. Webster's question, to take this money and apply it to the Eisenhower settlements would make the money just go away and not meet those needs. This is a tool to leverage and allow the town to borrow, which is not necessarily always a bad thing, to borrow and be able to make debt service payments on items like Eisenhower, like a roof at Town Hall, like the security system at school, at the school department. And I think when the municipal benchmarking study is presented to the town in a couple of weeks, you'll see that North Reading's general fund debt service is really pretty low compared to peers. Because borrowing is an important financial management tool. Just like we borrow for our homes or you borrow for a car, you don't always have the cash up front, and it's always not the wisest thing to do. And I think this is a wise thing to do to stabilize some, the financial management of some of our capital needs going forward. So I do support this article. Thank you.
Mr. O'Brien.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Just as a follow-up, what would be the impact if we were to pass over this article this evening? I do sympathize with what Mr. Masseri has said, and I understand fully what he means. But once again, I don't think this is the proper article for this evening. Would somebody tell me in a few words what the impact would be if we were to pass over and hold this off for 6 months until April?
Mr. Masseri.
The impact would be significant from the point of view of an article that's coming up regarding funding the Eisenhower land taking, the court settlements. We have to fund those court settlements. If we don't, at this town meeting, then we will have to reduce our current operating budgets by that amount of money. So that's a significant impact. And if we borrow the money to do that without this fund, then next year's budget will be increasing our debt service over the $960,000, and that comes off the top before we distribute the remaining amount to schools and general government. So the impact is like dominoes, one after the other, to the point where we'll have even less money for our operating budgets next year. And we all know that we ran a significant deficit this past year associated with that, which resulted in the layoff of teachers and the reduction of some town services.
Mr. Jerry. Steve Jerry, 21 Woodland Drive. And I'd like to take exception to the suggestion that this or any of the other articles of the warrant are improper. When the charter was first approved, it was the suggestion that most financial matters come before the April town meeting and most zoning items come before the October town meeting. But even then it was recognized that that would not always be feasible. Since then, with the passage of Proposition 2.5, it is virtually impossible for the town to manage its entire budget in April. And to continue to suggest that it is just flying in the face of reality.
Further discussion? Seeing none, all those, and this requires a two-thirds vote, it's a stabilization fund. All those for the article, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
Motion carries. I do declare a two-thirds majority. Article 6. Mr. Webster.
I move to borrow in accordance with provisions of generalized chapter 44, section 7, the sum of $400,000 for school building security improvements as specified in Article 6 as printed in the warrant.
We have the motion. Does the Finance Committee wish to make a recommendation?
Yes.
There will be a short presentation, not requiring the meeting. You want to wait for recommendations until after the presentation. Technology wonderful.
security aware.
That was 4 minutes for technical difficulties. We have a minute left for the presentation. Can I get away with that?
That was very good.
No, I don't think so.
Security of the computer system, so we're talking about security. Good evening, I'm David Phil, the superintendent. I'd like to spend a few minutes talking about why I feel it's critical to invest in the security in our schools. Part of our mission statement for the North Carolina Public Schools states that we provide a safe learning environment. And I'd like to talk a little bit about our school safety measures. We've been very invested in security in the school department for a number of years. We have in place a well thought out school safety plan. We work very closely with police officials here in North Reading and across the state under the STARS program, the School Threat Assessment Response System. We've done extensive staff training. We've implemented visitor passes in all of our schools. At our high school, each one of our staff members is assigned to sit in the lobby out here to greet people who are coming into the building for the first time. And last year, we subscribed to the AlertNow rapid communication system that sends out telephone and email in the event of a threat to school safety or for general information. What is missing in my judgment and in the judgment of our school safety committee is a well thought out security plan. I'm going to skip ahead here in the interest of time, but last fall we organized the school safety and security committee that has representation from the staff as well as from the community. And two of the members of that committee offered to do a complete assessment of safety in our five school buildings. And we looked at building access and security. We did a survey of the five buildings and we developed some goals. And the goals include to improve visitor and contractor, or anyone else who's not a visitor, coming into the building. How do they access the building? Who should be there? How do we monitor them? And we also want to determine the strict usage of perimeter schools. Most of our schools have many other doors other than the main lobby. For example, the Hood School alone has 28 exits in and out of this building, and that's pretty typical of school buildings. We'd also like to provide security tools to administration and also to law enforcement. So what we're going to talk about and what's being asked for in tonight's article is to fund security that focuses on the access and egress from our buildings and focuses on security systems, intrusion alarms, some surveillance cameras, and an increase in perimeter lighting. I'm going to skip through the assessment. If anyone would like the details of the report that was done, you can contact the school department. That report is filled with detailed information from each of the five schools. And I'd like to skip right to what I see as a three-year implementation phase. Year one, the total amount that's being requested is $400,000. And we'd like to roll that out over 3 years. In year one, which is the largest amount, is to focus on providing audible alarms on all doors, other than the main lobby. Because you can imagine people are coming and going out of buildings, very hard to monitor those doors. An audible alarm either gives a sound, or in the case of a remote annunciator, it would alert an office area that door number 25 in the building is open. We'd also like to install some digital keypads, because classes are oftentimes going in and out of the building. Physical education classes, recess. Teachers are taking the children in and out to the playground. Instead of coming all the way around back into the main office, we have locked all the doors now. And we do not want to give out keys to staff, because once you do that, you run the risk of breaching the security by losing those keys. We'd also like to phase in some video surveillance in the main areas. There is no intention here to do any kind of monitoring in classrooms or any other private areas. We're talking about the exterior of the building, to be able to see around the building what's going on the outside, and also in the lobby and in the cafeteria and perhaps the gymnasium. Year two, which would start next year, we're looking to install a buzzing system so that when school is in operation, anyone who's coming into the building would be recognized and allowed to enter. And then in year three, we'd finish the plan. Again, I said the budget was $400,000 to be bonded over as a two-year phase. I'd like to take you through a few pictures of our schools. This is the main door. There are two main doors into the middle school. The door that's kept open during the day is the door on the right. Right now, if the school was closed during the school day, someone would come to that door with a camera that would be fixed to the office, and someone would be able to buzz, and once the person had been recognized, would be allowed to come in. Right now, the only control system that we have in our buildings would be signs like this, that we encourage our visitors to come in and sign in the office. And in some of the buildings, that's not, even we're getting into the office is not something that is readily obeyed or understood by visitors in the school. Last week in one of the schools, we had someone who was in the lower level of the school, undetected, where a staff member asked that person, why are you, or who are you, and what are you doing here? And the person said that they were just simply looking for someone. That's not acceptable to us. And a sign like this is not going to defer that kind of control. We also issue visitor passes, so if you're a visitor or guest in the school, you should be wearing some kind of a very recognizable visitor pass. But again, this requires that there be a level of compliance, and it's certainly not going to prevent anyone from coming in. This is the middle school lobby. It presents a unique situation because the office, when it was built, is not visible to the lobby at all. We have installed a fixed camera. I don't know if you can see it, but I can tell you where it is because it's right up to the left of the no smoking sign. And this was a donation. It's one of the kinds of cameras that we're looking to install in the lobby. It would look like this, the one on the lower right. And here is, there's one monitor now inside of the middle school office where a secretary can see. You can't get a good view of that in a lobby, but this would be a slightly better view, can see what's going on in that lobby. Again, with an outside camera where someone is approaching it, the detail is very, very clear. This is the kind of problem that we have in all of our schools. People will say, I'm going to go outside just in my car for a minute or take and go out to the trash dumpster, and I'm going to prop the door open. But oftentimes, it's that moment when you can have a problem. We've had problems in our schools with kids from other school districts coming in, particularly here at the high school or in the middle school, searching out for another student. And with problems like this, on this particular door, which is into the cafeteria in the middle school, we would put a keypad entry so people who need to get back in would know how to get back in. Here's another sign. It's the sign that's typically here in the high school lobby. And again, you would put some kind of a buzzing system here. This door is one of the few doors in our high school and in the entire district that has an audible alarm. At the end of any of the major wings here in the high school, over the last few years, we've installed on the push bar an audible alarm. But all you need to do is jar it and a sound goes off. In a remote enunciator, it would send a signal to the office to say that not just the corridor door, but any of the doors from the classroom, if they were open, there would be some kind of either light or sound would go off in the office, and not a large audible alarm that would be more like a fire alarm. Here's a typical door at the little school. Virtually every classroom at the little school and the hood school has an access from the classroom out to the playground. These doors also would have either audible alarms put on them and or keypads. Now this is a door in the little school. This is the door that's used by all the children coming in and out from the playground. It used to be open. We would keep it open all the time. Now we're locking it for security reasons, but we're depending upon a staff member to pick up the key, use the key each time, but once you lose the key, these are master keys, you have compromised the security of the entire building. So our request then is for $400,000 for security. We feel that in this day and age, it
is certainly not a foolproof system, but it is a system designed to deal and provide a more secure and safe environment for children. Thank you.
For the presentation, does the Finance Committee wish to make a recommendation? Mr. Keller.
The Finance Committee is recommending on a 5-1 vote against this motion. Our reason is that there is coverage in the next article to provide security. We thought was a little bit too encompassing at this point.
Does the Board of Selectmen wish to make a recommendation? Mr. Passeri.
The Board of Selectmen does not recommend this article on a 4-1 vote.
Mr. Webster, does the school committee wish to make a recommendation?
The school committee unanimously recommends. Also want to state that the $150,000 that is in the warrant article to follow is not enough to cover the first year of our phase-in plan. We went back to the committee that did the survey and made the recommendations, and they feel that the amount we need for the first year will be more than that, $150,000. We'd like to get the $400,000 now and phase this in over 3 years. So school committee unanimously recommends.
Mr. Rowe.
I'm a little confused. Does the $400,000 cover all phases of the security system?
Yes.
And what then, going to the other article, what is the additional $150,000 for?
The $150,000, If this article passes, the $150,000 is not necessary. Mr. Luongo.
George Luongo, 18 Misery Road. I'm not in favor of this particular article either. I really don't feel that it's going to make our schools any safer for the young students in our community. I think it's a waste of money. It sounds like the school, has a system in place that seems to be working. I keep hearing that we're short of money. I don't think that if this had been part of the override, I don't think it would have gone through. I don't think that the general population would be in favor of this. So I would recommend that it not go through. And if there was some way that they could demonstrate that this would make it a safer environment for our young students in the schools. But I haven't heard that. Cameras and whatnot, all it's going to do is that if something happens, it will record it. The idea is to try to create a safe environment. And I think by training and educating not only the staff, but the students on how to keep their environment safe would be much more effective and better utilization of people's time and money. Thank you.
Mr. Reed.
Bill Reed, 17 Grand View Road. Just three quick questions. How many security breaches have we experienced in the last, say, 5 years or so, and how much did it cost to the school department? And I was wondering if there's anybody from the secondary school building committee here that could comment on how long the high school and the middle school are going to exist.
Mr. Trump.
The answer to your last question is I don't know. We hope that they exist for a period of time. On how long the high school and middle school will exist, I don't know the answer to that. To answer the general question in terms of the number of security breaches, I gave you one example of what happened last week, where a school, where someone came into the school building who went right past that sign, went right into the lower level of the school during the school day and was stopped, no, was in elementary school, was stopped by a staff member asking that individual what their business was in the school. Tragically, it's those kinds of events that we're trying to get a better handle on. Will it stop every person coming in? No. No system is fail-proof. We feel, though, and I think I would join my colleagues in other school districts, that this kind of security is necessary. We have been doing, over the last 5 to 8 years, extensive work on training on staff. I mentioned at the start the STARS program. The STARS program is a nationally recognized program. Chief Ed Nolan has been working very closely with us, training staff. We held yet another training program last spring with over 60 staff members involved. Each school has a crisis intervention team. We've been doing a lot of investment in terms of training students and staff. These tools, and I see these as security tools, are meant to deter, are meant to help outside safety officials in the event of a very serious situation. Last year in our middle school, it was public knowledge. We had a student put off a chemically reactive device right at dismissal time. And if we had had cameras around the perimeter, which part of this plan calls for, I think that probably would not have happened, or the likelihood of that happening would have been very minimal, because we would be announcing that we do these kinds of things. Security today is an issue. It's not the philosophy that as superintendent of schools, it's something that I wish to be spending a tremendous amount of time on. But it's unfortunately the reality. And I see this as a small piece of security that will lead to greater returns in terms of overall safety. Last Friday, in anticipation of town meeting, I put out on the superintendent's listserv questions, three questions. How many of you lock your doors? How many of you have cameras in your schools, either outside or inside? How many of you have some kind of a keypad or even a card swipe system? And immediately on Friday, and I did this as an afterthought, 47 school districts responded within half a day. And of the 47, 40 of them said, yes, we lock our doors in all of our schools. 40 of them said that we have some level of surveillance going on, not in classrooms. That's not the purpose here. The purpose is in the main areas and around the building. And only 18 said that they had the keypad entries, but that they were looking at those as a way to, in future building projects or renovation projects. Because looking at doors and facilities, in facilities that exist, can be a very costly affair. We're trying to focus first on the first two issues, and that's what year one and year two of this plan.
My name is Marian Delano, 8 Prospect Lane, and I am in favor of the security system. I think we as North Reading residents need to take a proactive approach and make sure that we protect our children. Our children are the future of North Reading. I'd say 10, 15 years ago, maybe we'd say, yeah, maybe we don't need it. But in today's society has pushed us to this. And to just ignore it and to say, no, we don't need it, that's not acceptable. We need to be proactive. Do you want to read the newspaper one day after you vote this down, read the newspaper that some gunman tragically disregarded the please no visitor sign and barged into the North Reading school and started shooting our children? How would we feel? I'm in definite favor of this, and I think you should all reconsider this. This is the future of North Reading we're talking about. We're talking about our children. Our children are the ones that are ultimately going to be running this town. So give them a fighting chance. That's all I ask. Thank you.
Tricia Colallo, 186 Haverhill Street. I agree that there needs to be security in the system, but I do feel that at this time this goes a bit too far. I think it's a bit too costly. We had a failed override for teachers and you're asking us to spend $400,000. I think that that partly is unfair to the students that are in crowded classrooms. I'd be more than happy to vote to approve the $150,000 in the next article, but as well as our five schools and protecting our children. We have town hall, we have a library, we have a DPW, we have other municipal buildings that could be just as at risk. And I would suggest that maybe you take the $150,000 in Article 7 and take a good look, sit Board of Selectmen, Finance Committee, School Committee, step back, take a step back and look at the entire town, all of our municipal buildings, and what we can do to not only protect the future leaders of North Reading, but protect the people that are currently running the town of North Reading.
Mr. Rowe.
I stand corrected. This should have been last April. This to me is an emergency situation. This is protecting our children and our teachers and the school system. The way things are today, we've seen it happen time and time again. And I don't agree with the amount of money the school committee spends, but I do think that this is a small amount to pay for the security for our children.
Mr. Steiner.
A couple of questions. Could someone please explain the phasing of the borrowing, I take it? So I'm just not clear on the $400,000 request and then the three phases. Little clarification. And then secondly, perhaps Chief Nolan or someone from the police department could give us your perspective about this and how you think this would be helpful to public safety.
On the borrowing, Mr. Webster.
The plan would be to borrow the $400,000 at one time and then phase in the project over 3 years.
What's the advantage of the phasing then?
I believe, Dr. Cronin, I believe it's, we wouldn't be able to do it all in 1 year, and we want to kind of phase it in, so, you know, there's an adjustment period, kids, staff know what's going on at the schools. I believe the plan is to have, in the phases, each school will have some level of security added in each phase. So we're not just saying we'll do the little and quit school 1 year, and the, so we'll phase it in all five schools over the 3 years. And by the end of the second year, and by 3 years, the end of the second year, we're talking the end of next school year, the end of the 2009 school year. 80 to 90% of it would be completed at the end of the second year.
Right. So it's 223. 883 plus an additional sum of money that'll be coming, that'll go into the Batchelder School that we still have from the Batch project.
And then the second year is $115,817. The third year is $60,000. So the majority of the project will be done by the end of the 2009 school year.
Chief Nolan.
To answer the question about the value of a security system installed in our school district, Dr. Trump mentioned that I was the commander of the STARS program, the School First Special Response System. It's recognized throughout Massachusetts and the United States as one of the foremost and preeminent programs for school security. So I do have some validation for my comments based upon my experiences. There are a significant number of school districts in this region that have fairly elaborate school security systems. Come to mind are Lawrence, Tewksbury, Reading, going down to a community as small as Groton, Mass. Have fairly elaborate school security systems installed. What is the value? Well, the value sometimes is subjective in nature. It's difficult to put a dollar value or a number on preventative measures. But common sense tells you that any kind of a security system, as well advertised, is deterrent for a number or a percentage of our population. It's not going to stop the aggressive individual who's bent on a mission-oriented person. It's not going to stop the psychologically impaired individual, but it does stop the average person that may be acting on an impulse when they realize that their actions may be caught on videotape or some kind of a system. So there is a value to that. There is a greater value to law enforcement post-incident as an investigatory tool. I can elaborate a tiny bit. As I mentioned before, Rotten had an incident similar to non-threatening last year, where there were a number of break-ins into their high school, and it involved the use of these chemical reactive devices. And the police department was able to access those videotapes, surveillance tapes, and after a brief investigation, they were able to identify the perpetrator. So in that sense, it becomes an aid. If during an incident that's ongoing, where you have an intruder in a school, we've been told by the school department that these devices will be available to the police department, a handheld device that will give us some idea where an intruder is in the building. So during a crisis, I can see that becoming a valuable tool to direct us very quickly to the direction of where a perpetrator is, so that it can enhance our ability to respond to the school. I can't speak to the dollar value of that, but I can speak to the value to the security of our children in our school system. Thank you.
Mrs. Davis.
Nicole Davis, 23 Burroughs Road. I believe the reason that the school committee is asking for all money up front is that we want a commitment to get the full system implemented over the 3 years. If we have to come back and ask for it a second time, a third time, we risk not getting that funding approved and having a halfway done security system. These measures can't protect against every threat, but they are reasonable precautions to take. Calling it a preventive measure, I would rather spend $100 on a vaccine against chickenpox for my child than spend $1,000 or more on a hospital visit. I mean, children die from chickenpox. I would rather spend the money to safeguard my child's health than risk anything worse happening to them. As a parent, I just want to know what level of risk is this community willing to accept? How open can we leave our schools safely? I don't know the answer to that. Last year we had a car school bus collision, and a lot of parents arrived before emergency services did. So there are certainly people in this town who are concerned enough about safety. Why shouldn't, if parents are that concerned that they're going to come to a fender bender, why shouldn't we take the steps to ensure that the only people who come into our school buildings are the people who belong?
Ma'am.
My name is Lydia Real Coxon, and I have moved into the North Reading as of January this year. And I have a high school student, and I also have a college. And while I do not sidestep the issue of my children's safety, security, and while in the public school system, I am concerned about the money and the way it's being spent. To implement a plan over 3 years does not guarantee me or give me a better sense of security for my children's safety in the school system. Two, the question as far as the amount of money that you're asking for, have these numbers been put forth by a security company? Do we have bids? Do we have valid proposals? Or is this all based on numbers? People gather and we say, well, this is what we think this will cost, and this is what another school system has implemented. And last but not least, I do not take my children's lives for granted. I've buried one son already. I will not bury another child. But I will not be held hostage by the fear of the possibility that if this override and money is not given, then my children will not be safe. As far as those people walking out those doors, propping the doors up, running to their cars, oh, I'll be right back, or let me take the trash out, that is where the administration and the staff need to be reminded. You jeopardize the children, you put your lives at risk, you jeopardize your own viability in the school system. It has to be a partnership. I don't have a problem giving the money, but honestly, it's just 3 years. Do the plan in full force, and get it out there, and send a clear message. But when you phase it in, what good does it do my son when he's graduated? What good does it do my toddler who starts kindergarten? But in the meantime, people have the ability to work around the system to be implemented. And last but not least, I repeat myself again. I'd like to know, where is the bids? Who is going to be implementing this security system? What company are we drawing from? Are they going to wait and work with us over 3 years? There are going to be cost increases, there's going to be time spent. You will be coming back. We're kidding ourselves if we don't. But stop holding hostage. Our children's lives are children's lives. Our children's lives, we know, are at stake, regardless of what we do or don't do. But put something realistic out there. Thank you.
Mr. Jeremy. Steve Jeremy, 21 Woodland Drive. I rose originally to address the question of money for a capital project versus the operating budget and the fact that we can't keep the schools open as many hours as we would like. We, as a community, we have to distinguish between operating expenses and capital expenses. This is a one-time thing for which we can borrow money. The operating budget is something that has to be raised every year. They can't be confused. The operating budget this year doesn't allow us to keep the schools open as much as we used to. To do that, we would have had to have compromised the education that is being given during the hours we are open, because the classes would have been so much larger that we think less education would have occurred, even though there were more hours. But that's a different question from the one-time expense that we're asking for what we see as a security need. Now, we've had a security committee addressing this over an extended period of time now. They have come up with, they include a couple of security professionals. They've come up with estimates that they feel will cover the full cost of this project. We can't go out to bid until we actually have money. That's the process that we have in the state. But a project this size will go out to bid. The money will be spent as is, will be borrowed as it is spent in whatever way the town treasurer determines makes sense. But the request is for the $400,000. So that when we look for a bid, we can express the full extent of the project and know that we're going to be able to do the entire project. The first year is designed to meet what we consider the most serious needs of the project, making sure that the doors are secure. Right now, a child can wander out of a classroom and, depending on the circumstances, might not be immediately noticed. Those doors are not alarmed. A child might see, we know of cases in our society where there are parents at odds about jurisdiction over children. We don't want someone coming to a door and inducing a child to open it and then disappearing when the other parent actually has custody. There are all kinds of situations. We have situations that jeopardize teachers, we have situations that jeopardize children. But we're not trying to hold people hostage here. We're trying to make what we consider to be the most reasonable proposal for a reasonable level of security. This is determined not simply by us in North Reading. North Reading is the kind of community where we took this issue seriously, but we did not rush into it. And the statistics Dr. Troughton gave you bear that out. Of the 47 superintendents that have responded already to a request he only made on Friday, 40 already have this kind of security in their systems. It is deemed prudent to at least be able to control access to the building. And as Chief Nolan pointed out, that won't prevent everybody from getting in, but at least you'll know immediately if there's a breach, you'll be able to contact security and safety officers, and the sooner you have people addressing the problem, the safer the situation will be. So I urge you to support this program because competent people have investigated the needs, and these are the recommendations of professionals who have studied the matter. Thank you.
Elaine Gaskowitz, Ted Passage Lane. I'd like to know why the Selectmen and the Finance Committee oppose this article, and I'd like to know the $400,000 that you have budgeted, will that also include hiring people to man the security system, or will it be extra money that you'll need later for that? Because I don't think the secretaries in the schools will be doing that work. Thank you.
Mr. Messeri?
I'll respond to the question regarding the Board of Selectmen. The Board of Selectmen is, if you talk to each individual member, I think you'd find we all have a little different opinion as to this expenditure. Personally, I ask the question, what problem does it really solve? My thoughts are that most issues, serious issues that happen within the school system happen from the student body itself. So locking the doors does not necessarily prevent that kind of a problem. I am in support of some cameras within the building or surrounding the building associated with allowing public safety to react when there's an incident that might occur in the school. I'll leave it up to my other fellow board members to explain their position on the issue. I am in support of the capital expenditure of $150,000, which I think gets some of the major issues that the school department is concerned with covered. And I certainly would be willing to accept additional expenditures in future years.
Mr. Kelleher for the Finance Committee.
Like the Board of Selectmen, we also have a concern about security. Our issue with this particular article had to do with the amount and the timing of it. I think the consensus of our committee is that we need to secure the schools, that that access be control so that not anyone can walk into the schools. We're not of a uniform view that security cameras, unless you staff somebody to be monitoring those cameras, that you've got in place other costs which are not in the capital costs to deal with it, are going to be terribly effective. Locking the school, restricting access to it, knowing who's in the building, annunciators on doors, alarms on doors so that there's a breach of the door, that is noticed. Perhaps keypads on selected doors. We don't believe that there needs on every door, because not every door is a door that's going to have should have in and out access all the time. But there certainly are doors that will have that kind of access. So we believe that the security is important, and we're not minimizing that at all. We're thinking of it in different terms. We think that the article, the amount in Article 7, ought to be adequate to cover those needs.
Mr. Hayden, oh, Mr. Hayden, hold on one second. Are you going to address the question? Yeah, Dr. Trotman, I'm sorry.
I'd like to address Mrs. Jasper's question about staffing. But probably by doing that, let me first give you a detailed description of what the complete plan would look like at the Hood School, one of our elementary schools. We would equip all of the fire exit doors with the audible alarms, with remote annunciators, so that if there is an opening, there is an alarm going off all the time. But that there would be communication back to the office, and it would be very visible. You would not need a special staff member to know that door number 18 was open. We would install the main entrance video intercom with a buzzing system. That would be at each of the schools. That will require a level of staffing, and given the frequency of people coming to and from the school building, we would expect either the school secretary or the paraprofessionals or the principal to be able to respond. These devices are set up on the buzzing systems so that more than one person does not have to be at a fixed location to be able to open that door. We feel, based on the information that we have, that could be handled with present staff. I know that in larger schools, for example, at Lawrence High School, the New Lawrence High School, which is actually five high schools in one, they employ full-time security people because of the complexity of that system. We would install only two digital keypads. Again, at doors that are frequently used other than the main lobby, where children are coming to and fro during the day. And it would allow a staff member to gain entrance instead of giving them a key. So it's the responsibility of the staff member anyway to bring that group of children in and out. We would install at the Hood School 9 fixed closed circuit television. Most of those are around the building and perimeter. And they could be set to record off hours or at different times. We would install at the Hood School two pan, tilt, and zoom. This is the kind of technology that Chief Nolan was referring to. It's particularly useful for law enforcement or any safety officer coming in would have access to that and be able to see what was going on in the event of an emergency. And that we would, all of that would be digital, so it would have to be set into a network that would be in the office. So from a staffing standpoint, we don't intend to employ individual security people at each of the buildings. We feel that at the level that we're recommending, if we would use existing staff in the office to be able to manage that technology and not be looking at it with an operating cost to go above and beyond. We're not that large. We do not think that it would be warranted.
Mr. Hayden.
Chris Hayden, 20 Swan Pond Road. I'm not in favor of this article. I am in favor of security for the school's locks, audible alarms and fire exits. I'm really dismayed that we just renovated three elementary schools, and they don't have that. They do have, I know the back has a much better front door entrance where the secretary can see whoever enters. But we don't have we can't really lock down the school the way we'd like to. Some doors that are open during the day. But let's fix it now, I suppose. There's a lot of things that can go wrong with technology. Getting the doors locked, I think, is a great way to go. And having a master key, no one should have a master key in your schools as a teacher. You should have a front door key and a gymnasium key. If someone loses it, you change that lock, which is still master. So it's a different thing than a master key. And then someday you can use that same cylinder somewhere else within the school, and the person will never know what key they found. Maybe a 1 in a million shot that they find that lock again. But there's, you know, who's going to maintain this system? We have a press box out here at the football field, that's had a broken lock for 6 to 8 months, you've secured that with two pieces of strapping and some sheetrock screws. Well, that's not secured. I can get in there and get to all the electrical equipment that's in that press box. It's a $200 lock to replace that, but we haven't done that yet. So if we stop breaking cameras, or if they fail, or a recorder fails, how are those going to get replaced? Where's the money going to come? I do agree with securing schools, but your best way to secure your schools is through your STARS program, if it's adhered to. If the people who put those items in the door to prop the door open, did they go to their STARS program? I don't know, because they weren't adhering to that protocol. The person that was found in the basement, that was the proper thing to do. If you come across someone that doesn't belong in the school, you have to ask who they are and escort them back to the office. I don't even know if we have to have remote enunciators for the fire doors, as long as there's a classroom next to there, because every classroom has an intercom to the office. That teacher should be out there finding out what's going on in the hallway immediately, and they can communicate by in person to the office to tell you what's going on. But even that, I can understand that, having the enunciator back to the office, because if something happened at night, you could always get back in there and see what doors open. So I'm not really in favor of this article. I do support the $150,000 that's in Article 6. Thank you.
Seven.
Mrs. Bailey.
Thank you, Mr. Moderator. Marcy Bailey, 21 Gwynn Drive. A few comments. I recently had the opportunity to visit the reconstructed police station. It appears to be fully camera. Granted, it's a police station, but still, there's someone at the front desk all the time. There's camera in the lobby, there's camera outside, you know, full visibility. The library recently added surveillance cameras after several security problems. There was an act of vandalism this summer. A security camera helped the police solve who did it and address the issue. It helps the librarians feel safer, and it provides a level of comfort and insurance to the town, to the town's residents, and to the town employees. So the library, it was called for there. It's been of assistance already. I think the security committee, I know that they've spent a lengthy time at this. They've given their expertise as security with several security professionals on the committee. I don't pretend to know what is an adequate and full security system, and I wouldn't, frankly, here tonight second guess them. The town each and every year spends, dare I say, tens of thousands of dollars or more on liability insurance, on property insurance, and hopefully we never, never have to use it. But it doesn't mean we don't buy it. We buy it because it protects our interests, both in terms of property, financial, and people, ultimately, being able to take care of our people should there be a tragedy. This is another level of insurance. Maybe it's paid one time in a capital need and approved separately as a separate article, but each and every year, like I said, tens of thousands of dollars is spent in a similar form of insurance to this. So I don't see too much difference. Finally, I came in tonight, and I wasn't really sure whether I supported this article or the partial plan. After listening to the arguments, I support this article. I've seen too many times the road program, the technology plan, will fund it piecemeal, and we'll hit it again next year. And next year, there's not enough money. So we've gone and we've made an investment, but only a partial investment, not something that fully serves the needs of the town and the needs of the town's people. So I think that if we are committed to this plan, we've heard a recommendation from the security committee, we've heard $150,000 that won't buy year one of that, and I'm not sure, I haven't heard what value that's gonna buy and what full value that's gonna add. I think it's time to step up and do it right the first time, rather than wrong a little bit 3 years in a row. So I urge everyone at town meeting to support this article tonight, as I will. Thank you.
Mr. O'Leary, for the minority report from the Board of Selectmen.
For the minority report from the Board of Selectmen, I vote for the...
I'm shocked.
What's that?
I'm shocked.
I'm shocked, yeah. And again, let me just echo Mr. Bailey's sentiments. What is anybody on the board that isn't in favor of security, some level of security in the school department, in the school system? It's needed. There's no doubt. just a question of implementation and how much are we going to invest at what period of time or what time period. And as Mrs. Bailey so lately promoted here, the position of all too often we buy into a program and a piecemeal approach and never finish it, whether it be the financial constraints, a change of heart, change of mind, change of people who are here in the audience at any particular given point in time, where we make a major investment in programs, and as we try and phase it in over 3, 4, 5 years, we're unable to complete the job and we've actually made a substantial investment on something that's incomplete. I know personally that two of the people who are on the security committee are security professionals who are residents of the town of Albany, who have had kids go through and have kids in the public school system. We're all taxpayers, both taxpayers, but the resident professionals in the security field that don't need their time and expertise to study this matter and report back to the school committee. I'm not going to second guess their expertise. I'm not going to second guess their motives or intentions because they can't be honest because they're party to it. So, I think if we're going to implement the program, we should buy into it and pay for it. And we're talking about paying for it and phasing it in over a 3-year time frame, the bulk of which is going to be in the first 2 years. The number that you see in the warrant for the next article, $150,000, was kind of a number that was initially talked about in the early stages of phasing before they had to report to the security committee. The actual amount is $250,000, $25,000 approximately, which is going to come from this remainder of funds that are in the special school project to take care of that. It's $223,488 to be borrowed for phase one in year one, not $150,000. You know? So to me, we're more than halfway there, and two-thirds of the way there, the first year is what's needed. Let's do it once, let's do it right, let's implement it, phase it in over the 3 years, most of it's going to be done in the first two. I think it's a more cost-effective, effective way of doing and implementing a program that's necessary. I've been very apprehensive and dismayed that our society has gotten to the point where we have to take these types of security measures in order to protect our children. But it's out of the times and we have to do it. Just as an aside, one of my co-workers, one of my bosses at work, she monitors her daughter at daycare on her computer working time. She can log in at any time and watch her kid at daycare. The entrance to the daycare, the rear entrance to the daycare, the playground area, and inside the daycare facility. That's the type of security systems that are in place now for our preschool children. Well, those people are paying for it and are necessary, unfortunately. So I think we need to take a realistic approach. We're at this point in time, and I know the school powers are reluctant to implement this program or even suggest it at this point, but we're there. We're at the point where we have to do it. So let's do it once, let's do it right, and let's phase it in and buy it from the program.
Jeff Hill, 427 Park Street, Albany.
Is the secondary school committee considering a security system in the process that they're going through in evaluating what to do in high school and middle school?
Mr. Jerry, for the question.
It's an awkward answer I have to make for you. Yes, we're certainly considering it, but the new state rules don't allow us to consider anything in too much detail until they give us permission. It's one of these things where if we tell them what we want, they're going to be offended. They have to pretty much feel that they're controlling the process. But yes, we are considering security. I can't envision a new school being built without modern security. Now, we're also looking at equipment, some of which we would be able to transport if needed.
Thank you.
Ms. Mullen.
Rita Mullen, 163 Chestnut Street, North Reading. We have a probably 40-year voter, Italian Catholic. I'm going to have guilt no matter what happens. That's the way it goes. But in talking to the people in the in the schools that are for and against it, a couple of things that I hear and scare me to go either way on this one is there going to be the maintenance on this? If you buy it, is there a maintenance every year that we need to look at, or it's 400 something? Is the life expectancy 10 years, 20 years, whatever?
Are we going to put it in high school or middle school? Because obviously the place isn't well attended tonight, like we're usually the parents vote for the school thing. So yes, they're concerned about safety, but they can't bother showing up, I'm not sure. So if we put it in the high school or middle school and we do decide to take them down later, can we save the equipment that goes in there, put them someplace else? What I see in here is, and being on the committee for a year, sometimes we're careful what we suggest, because if we vote for this, the next year the parents not vote to support the budget because they say, I already gave you $500,000 for security, I'm not giving you anything else. The half day was a major impact and not certain on the school system fall. The half day was a major, major impact. And I look at it sometimes, I hate to say it, but there's more of a chance the kids can get hit by a car because there are more kids on Wednesday and get hurt seriously because they're, you know, so where do you weigh the problems that can happen in the school are out there. Lights around the building, I know just a little school at night, there are no lights when you come out after, you know, PTO meetings or things there. How much of this money, if any, is going into outside lighting and things like that? Is there a certain amount of that? Because I think maybe those things have been broken down a little bit so people can actually visualize. And I came in here tonight not knowing which way to vote for it. And after still hearing everything, you know, you can sympathize both ways, but it's very difficult if people are going to vote for this next year that they might vote for it, because we shouldn't have had all the money put in the, according to me, all the money put in the system last time, so we didn't have to cut the teachers. You know, just 400-something thousand, we had 8 teachers over 1 year, that to me, more security, more help in the school is going to save kids from drug overdoses and other things, so depends how you balance the lives. It's all needed, just, you know, somebody give me an idea, somebody turn the switch on so we know which way to vote on this. Thank you.
Mr. Harris.
I have 2 issues with this article. For one, tell me that I should buy notes off of whatever you want, but the idea is... Yeah. Really?
Hello?
Yeah. All right, you can tell me that I see black helicopters all over the place, but the idea of putting cameras up in the school kind of scares the hell out of me. What are we trying to show these kids that we're watching them all the time in the prison? I don't think it scares me, it makes me nervous. And another thing, my experience in the last year has showed me that the first number we see is never the number that we finish with. And I'd like to echo what Chief Nolan said, saying that if we decide to put this through and we have these cameras at Pan, Tilt, and Zoom, who's going to be monitoring them? And for how long each day? And what are we going to be paying these people? How much is it going to cost to fix this system when it breaks down or eventually becomes obsolete? I don't think we've had enough time to look at this, first of all. And second of all, I don't like the idea of watching these kids all day long. It makes me nervous.
Further discussion. Seeing none, we'll move to the vote. This is to be funded through bonding, so it requires a two-thirds vote. I can declare it unless I'm in doubt. So we'll see what happens. So all those in favor, please say aye.
Aye.
Opposed?
No.
The chair is in doubt. Would my tellers please come forward?